We begin our program with broken hearts in another American town, which today became the site of yet another deadly school shooting.
17 people killed in a mass shooting at a Florida high school.
This is Parkland tonight, points of light shining in the darkness.
I'm sorry, guys.
I don't believe that this insane monster should have ever been able to obtain a firearm.
I think the only thing I can do to help in this situation is go ground floor, talk to a bunch of people that were in the shooting, outside of the shooting, teachers of the school, the Parkland County Commissioner, and figure out what needs to be done and give that message to as many people as I possibly can.
Going to meet with Jonathan and his mom, Melissa, right now. His mom has said that he is just lost and used to be filled with like a ton of joy, and now when she looks at him, it's like there's emptiness. I just want to become homies with him and just be there for him.
Hey.
When I found out that there's a shooting at Stoneman, so I was texting JB right away, and I said, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" And I didn't have any answer. I didn't hear from him. I texted him again, "Are you okay?" And there was no answer. I finally got a text saying, "Mom, people are being shot in my room, dying." And then that was it. I didn't know if my child was dead or alive. I had no response.
Did you ever think that would happen to you as a parent or as someone who works in the school system?
No. I mean, we live, you know, in Parkland. Those things don't happen here.
Your feet are in this video that went viral.
Yes.
Where it's one of the videos that was like posted everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Are these the shoes?
Yeah, these are.
Those are the shoes from mm-hmm. the video?
Yeah. I was laying down, and I guess I was just laying flat on the ground, and I guess someone just took the video and my feet were in it. At first I thought it was a drill. We didn't know what was going on. We've been practicing for drills like this just to make sure that we're okay and safe. So at first I heard a bunch of pops. I thought they were just fake at first, but I still went down as fast as possible. As I was going down, I realized that it was real. Bullets went through my door. Two people killed in my classroom and two others were shot and injured. And half of the class went to one side of the class and then the other half went to the other side of the class, and they were in the line of sight, and some people got shot in my class on the other side.
He was basically just like sticking his gun through
the door, pretty much, like just spraying through the door.
Through the window of the...
100%, both of the kids in my class, they would have been saved if the bulletproof windows were put in. For us, it's safety. It happened, and that's one way that you need to fix it and make sure that it doesn't happen again. If the shooter knows that there's bulletproof windows, or if the shooter knows that there's more cops on campus, then they're not gonna go to the schools. So, unfortunately, school shouldn't be a place where you have to have many guards and cops, but if that's what it takes to be safe, then that's what it's gonna have to be.
Why did you choose like to feel comfortable to open up to me specifically?
Honestly, it's just easier to come out to talk about what's going on with someone than you, than a doctor, someone. That's just a person that's their job. This isn't your job. You're just coming here to talk to me.
I have to tell you, it was the best therapy for my son, because when I heard him speak to you, he hasn't spoken to anybody. You didn't have an agenda, you cared. And you have to understand what that means to these kids. They just need the support.
Talking to them, I learned so much. Something that like I even thought when I was in school is like, oh, this isn't gonna happen to me. I think everyone overlooks this. But since 2013, there's been a gun incident at schools every week. When you think of a statistic like that, instead of just being a bystander, people should realize, hey, this could be me next, or my kid.
I lost one of my really good friends, actually. He was like a little brother to me. He was a freshman, he's 14. Luke. I think we read about all these other school shootings like in the past, like we see them on TV, and I think we just kind of let them slip past us most of the time, and we don't do things like go to Tallahassee and talk to all the politicians there, we're going to DC in March. Like, we're just doing things that we wouldn't have done if it wasn't our school. And I think other people need to understand that. Like, we regret not helping the students of those other schools when they needed it. So I think we expect them to be here for us also.
Look, this isn't about red and blue. We can't boo people because they're Democrats and boo people because they're Republicans. Anyone who's willing to show change, no matter where they're from, anybody who's willing to start to make a difference is somebody we need on our side here.
Hey, what's up, man?
Gotcha now.
I think like a lot of people think passing laws is super easy. Can you explain some of like the struggles around passing laws?
So what I'm trying to do is kind of figure out, all right, what are the things we agree on? And let's do those things first. You know, it makes sense. We agree on these 8 things, let's do these 8 things. And then there's some things we may not agree on. We can, phase 2 will be to go work on some of those things. But let's get the things we agree on out of the way. Why wait to do the things that we agree on? You know, especially because it's so hard.
Is there anything that people can look forward to? Is there something new that you're working on? Or is there something specific?
What we learned about Parkland was that, like most of these shootings, it isn't like some guy wakes up in the morning in a bad mood and goes by as a guy and kills a bunch of people. It's generally someone that over a couple of years has been getting worse and worse. I think in like 8 out of 10 of these cases, they actually tell someone before they do it that this is what they're going to do. And sometimes people just don't take it seriously. And in this case, people did, right? They called the sheriff's office, they called the FBI, but nothing happened. So one of the first things we learned from this is we got to be better at identifying who these people are way ahead of time.
So, Senator Rubio, can you tell me right now that you will not accept a single donation from the NRA in the future?
One thing we're working on is a law called Stop School Violence, which provides federal money for states to set up these systems. That, like, if they have it in LA, where they can identify the problem people and get ahead of it before it happens. And then the other is a restraining order, where you can be able to go to a court and show them their Instagram posts, the videos, or, you know, whatever it is they're doing, and say, look, this guy's got a problem. He's going to hurt somebody or hurt themselves, and get a court order to stop them from buying guns and to take away the ones they already have so they don't, you know, go into a school and do what happened here.
Look, the First Amendment is as important as the Second. And therefore, you have every right to ask that question of me, and I'm here to tell you that I will stand for the things.
Are you going to be accepting money from the NRA in the future?
I've always supported, I will always accept the help of anyone who agrees with my agenda. But
guys,
the influence of any group.
We're going to be here all night.
The influence of these groups comes not from money. The influence comes from the millions of people that agree with the agenda. So the millions of Americans that support the NRA and who support gun rights groups.
Guys.
We're a country where there's a lot of disagreements about what our gun law should be and what should be allowed or not allowed. Those disagreements existed before Parkland, and they're going to be going on. No matter what happens, even if those laws are changed, there'll be another side of millions of people that disagree. The best thing to do here is to stop someone before they even show up at the school and shoot it up. And I would just say that we haven't had another 9/11, and it isn't because of TSA. You know, TSA does not really disrupt terrorist plots at the end. They're there, and they have to be. But the way we really disrupt these plots is we find out who the terrorists are before they do it, and we arrest them. We don't even let them get to the airport, much less get on the plane. And we gotta take the same attitude with this.
All right, so we learned that Mr. Rubio is working on a couple of different laws, and he explained some of his struggles on passing laws, which is kind of why I wanted to make this video in the first place, is to activate parents and kids within their own schools and communities. That's the way things are gonna get done the fastest. We don't wanna wait for, you know, hundreds of people in Washington, D.C. to pass some laws. There's so many disagreements. I think we're at a point now where there's people in legislation, people in power, people like me, people like you guys at home watching this, students, parents, whoever may be watching this, where we all want the same thing, and that's to make schools safe.
Day two. In Florida, still trying to figure out as much information as we can, meet with whoever we can to figure out the best ways to help and push forward with this movement.
I think the world seeing that it's your generation that's going to get stuff done on whatever the issues may be, because we see how quickly they can mobilize on something that's passionate to them. And it's not just the Stoneman Douglas High School students. I mean, they're amazing, but all the students from all around the world we're seeing. Or, I mean, you know, when people joke around, hey, it's not like it used to be, and these kids are not like the way we were when we were younger. Parkland is not going to let itself be defined by this incident. How we're going to be defined and how you guys are going to be defined in your generation is by the response. And the response is going to be a good response, and we'll take it from there.
Like, right before this, I was worried about, like, my prom dress and, like, right, where I was going during the weekend. And now we have to worry about, like, whose funeral we're going to and what we're wearing to the funeral. It just should be about the kids. Like, it shouldn't even be about political parties.
So I'm on the second floor bathroom, and I hear 10 to 15 shots go off, but I'm thinking it's a movie next door. Like, there's no way there's a shooter in my school. Like, Douglas was voted like the safest place. I took two people next to me, and we ran out of the bathroom, ran to the first classroom we saw, and we knocked on the door, but there was no response because everyone was in hiding.
Right.
So we weren't let in. And then as we were running to the second door across from that room, I looked left, and Nick, the shooter, was going into the stairwell.
180 rounds remained in the rifle that the killer dropped. Still no understanding or explanation for why the killer dropped that rifle and the rounds he had in it.
Apparently his plan was to set off the fire alarm and go up to the top of the building and see all the kids running, and then, because he had 180 rounds left. And his gun apparently was jammed.
Yeah, his gun jammed.
I think he was definitely an outcast. I really think he didn't fit in with everyone. And I think that might have led him, as well as, like, he had a bunch of tragedies in his life. You know, his parents died, his foster dad died, he's autistic, and it just simply piled on top of each other, and he's really had a hard life. But that's not anyway justifying what he did. It's just that we have to understand that there is also an issue with the emotional aspect of schools. We got to look at, like, the mental stability aspect of young kids and make sure that we have the mental assistance for them, and to make sure that they're not ostracized from community and they always have backing and support. That's really important. We don't have the emotional grief counselors at our school to help out with that.
We have an amazing community, I will tell you that. And we are strong, and we do have a voice. And some kids speak louder than others, and some kids do it their own way, in their own, how they want to do it. But however anyone can get the word around that change needs to be made, let them do it.
For me, it's not political. It doesn't matter what side you're on at all. I think everyone should come to agree that this just can't be happening. It's everyone's kids, no matter if you're a Republican or Democrat, it's everybody. So everyone needs to come and realize that.
Did you guys know the shooter at all before?
Yeah.
You did?
Oh, yeah.
And would he be someone you would suspect?
100%, I knew my mind, because in middle school he rode our bus every day along with his brother Zach, and he was always known as someone odd, someone off, someone who doesn't seem like...
troubled.
Someone who's troubled.
He's done this, he jumped off the bus window, he flicked the bus driver off.
Yeah.
And so everyone knew about it.
Everyone
had complaints. He wasn't allowed to bring a backpack to school. He had a clear Ziploc bag.
He wasn't allowed to have anything because he was such a threat. And also the police showed up to his house 39 times. The FBI was tipped off about it. From other kids,
neighbor,
but nothing happened. Like, he was definitely a threat to everyone, but no one took it seriously.
Is there a message that you would want everyone to know?
Nobody should ever have to go through what I went through. It was the scariest moment of my life, and no person should ever own an automatic machine gun. It's like a weapon of war. and it's to kill people. It's not to protect yourself, and it just shouldn't be allowed.
And if there is a message that you could give to the community about change, what would that be?
Kind of just to keep the fire going and to not let like the days go by, like slow it down, to just keep going until we actually see something that changes.
There's a ton of information that I learned from the families and the students who are actually in the freshman building and the Parkland County Commissioner. I walked away with like about five big things. Every family that I talked to talked about having bulletproof windows inside on the doors. It could have saved 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 lives. Number two was having more school resource officers. I actually found out from the Parkland Commissioner that they have like 200 and something schools and roughly only like 150 school resource officers. So on a lot of their schools, some of them don't even have officers there. And specifically Parkland had 3,200 students, which is a big school, and there was one school resource officer. Having more school resource officers allows more ears throughout the school to figure out, oh, the people are complaining about this kid. People are saying that this kid's bad. Someone said that that kid is having a party. Whatever it might be, the more school resource officers there are, the more information they're gonna have to be able to help these kids. A third thing that I found out, which is crazy, is I believe these big social media companies should also have a moral responsibility. Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, you know, like I know on Instagram, if a girl posts a picture with her nipples out, like it automatically gets flagged and removed from Instagram and like reported under a system. So why can't we have that same technology with a kid taking a selfie with a handgun or a kid in a video killing animals? Like that should pop up on someone's radar, and these big companies should have the moral responsibility to add that to their flagging systems. The fourth thing that I gathered from a lot of people was, and this one was kind of odd, I was talking to one student in particular, there are like these bulletproof shields that can fit into laptop pouches of backpacks. If I was a student again, back in 2012, and I knew this information, I wouldn't have gone to school another day without one of those in my backpack. Number five, in this specific school, since it's Florida, there's like it's an open campus and there's not really like a check-in point. If there was a check-in point, then this kid would have had to go by the check-in point. He would have had to have his ID. He would have had a reason for being there. Again, you're a mom, you're a kid, you're a parent, and your school doesn't have a check-in point. That's something you can easily go to them and say, look, we need to implement this. Again, like I said, the biggest thing when talking to these kids was they never thought it would happen to them. Parkland, Florida, amazing, like wealthy community. And people just need to take it seriously and have communications with their principals, with other students, with their parents, on how everyone can get involved to make their school a safer place. So I met this family who was willing to have us follow their journey as they try to make schools a safer place. And maybe that will help you figure out how you want to help or how you want to get involved. I feel like with like the information that I gathered and you being a teacher and your son being a student, it'd be perfect for us to use this as a case study on like how we can go to the people in our schools, go to the other students, and actually make a difference and show the rest of the world how to as well.
We want to do that because what I realize is that a lot of times we've become so desensitized that we'll talk about it for a little bit and then it goes away and we don't actually push the issue any further.
Exactly, yep.
So we're definitely, you know, ready to team up with you guys to kind of make sure that change comes about.
What we're gonna be doing is following their progress, figuring out what they're learning, and expanding on some of the things that I learned to be able to make schools a safer place. I'm personally going to donate $25,000 to help be a part of this cause. There's a march on March 24th in Washington, D.C. that a ton of people are going to. If you want to be a part of the march, I'm also making sure that part of my money is paying for two buses that are going to take students down there. If you want to be a part of that, it's on March 24th. I'll put the information below. Go be a part of the march. Make your voice heard. And if this video, or by you showing this video to one other person, if it saves one life, then we're successful.
My hands smell like cigars. Your breath will smell the same. If we wake up and it's still dark, will you call out my name? You tell me not to fear, but I feel so alone. 'Cause I cannot forget my dear, I feel it in my bones. So tell me one last time how you love my wild side, how you adore the freedom that soars behind my eyes. Tell me that you'll wait till I am in a better place. Tell me that you love me, 'cause there's no time to waste.